I'm your host, Kari Ilonummi, with the NoSpendNewsSource.com monthly report for July 2014. This is the 3-year anniversary of NoSpendNewsSource.com, along with being on what would be Twitter and Facebook as well. So this is very exciting. So the official date is what would be the 11th of this month, July, at 11:11 a.m. So I have some celebrating to do, and so do you. Now, before we get too going into the articles, which we will be discussing a whole array of things today, let's start out with the interview of what would be Telly Blackwood, which is a professional wrestler and actor, very well known, lots of followers and people. Well, this individual, Mr. Blackwood, has decided to become politically active lately, and he's been harassed. Folks in the federal government wanted to know what his connection was to specifically Alex Jones. So when it gets to the point to where your freedom of speech, your right to peacefully assemble, and all other freedoms, which I can go on and on about, from taxes to firearms to you name it, your right to do your own thing in your own home, when it gets to the point when the federal government comes questioning you at your own home, and these folks came into his home without a warrant. They walked right in. They felt right at home. And they asked him questions. So, allow Mr. Blackwood to tell you his experience, and we'll catch you on the other side of this break. Thank you.
Don't take our kindness and our reserve as weakness. We're doing everything we can to not let you have your civil war. Now, you know, thousands of articles a day saying I'm behind the shooting in Las Vegas, that I need to be shut down, that I need to be investigated, that I need to be looked at, that I'm to blame. MSNBC, CNN, all of it, okay? They're coming after me, state-run media. Because they can take Alex Jones down, Drudge is next, World Net Daily's next, and then everybody else. And then the free speech, and then your bank account. Telly Blackwood. Telly Blackwood, I'm always saying Kelly Blackwood. I've interviewed him many times. Twitter.com/IamLeatherface, the famous wrestler, one of the most famous wrestlers, say in the top 20 easily, that folks have grown up watching. And he's also been in a lot of TV movies and a lot of major films. He's a very successful actor in his own right. He's on with us, and I appreciate him coming on until 5 after next hour. He got a DHS visit where they walked right into his house, past his girlfriend, because he burned some toast, and the front door was open. He was in the back door with his garden. He'll tell you the story. With two guys in black fatigues with their hands on their hips, with a big guy in a suit asking him about Alex Jones and other things. And this has happened to other people, but they never want me to talk about it. And this is just meant to be a message to me. Well, I mean, I'm right here, FBI, Secret Service, ATF, State Police. I mean, you've been here before. All I'm doing is trying to not have a civil war and have freedom and not get cops killed. So I'm blamed because I want to stop the civil war that's going to kill hundreds of thousands of you and hundreds of thousands of citizens. Because I'm trying to stop it, I'm blamed with it. Anybody that listens to this show or anybody that spies on it knows the truth. And if you want to sign on with George Soros and the New World Order, go ahead. I've made my decision which side I'm on in history, and so has Telly Blackwood. Telly, thank you so much for coming on, sir, today. Tell us what happened to you yesterday, please, sir.
Greetings, the evil Dr. Jones. As of yesterday, waking up and enjoying my little morning in the garden out here, I was the most pretty smoky in the house. We had both doors open. And I guess at some point in time, probably around 9:30, two men, some fatigues, another guy in a suit, came to the door and asked my girlfriend to stop the couch there. It's Telly Blackwood here. And she has said yes, but it was really easy to see me get up down through the back door there from the front, sitting on the ground there, digging. And they pretty much just invited themselves in right away, and she didn't say, yeah, come on in. She just said yes, kind of looked back where I was.
And you were engaging in a primitive pro-human activity of agriculture. That probably freaked him out right there, because that's a sign of, gardening's a sign of, I'm serious, it's a sign of evil to them. Go ahead.
It's all organic, too, so.
Whoa.
Melt them. Oh, yes, that's a crime. Anyways, they make their way back out here, and I'm kind of, my back's turned to the door, and I'm not really expecting this, and all of a sudden I turn back, and there's three guys right behind me, so, my big old self, I
And Telly, Billy, speak up a little bit. Speak up a little.
Okay. I hop back as soon as I notice you guys come up behind me, and he immediately flips out a badge. But, like, I see it's the DHS, you know, symbol, whatever. He does it go fast and flips it. He's all out of Mr. Black. That's the question for you.
And I would say, what's your name? Let me have your card. You know, where's your warrant? What are you doing in my house? I'm not saying you're wrong. I understand they snuck up on you. That's why they do that.
Yeah, then the thing is, what was the question for you? You currently own any firearms and are any kind of antidepressant drugs, and your name is Xanax and a couple other things. So I'm just sitting here like, what the hell are these guys? What is this? And the thing is, so instead of answering those questions, I just asked them simply, my question for you, do you have a warrant or a reason why you're here? And I'm just kind of totally confused, and he started blurting out some kind of code with a number and a letter at the end of it, and I would have a right to investigate and talk to you and be here, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, no, they have a right to come knock on your door and try to talk to you. You have no responsibility to talk to them.
Yeah, well...
But he should not have walked into your house. I would file a trespass complaint on record.
So I asked him, well, do you have a warrant or who let you in? You know, then he just kept mumbo jumbo, and went ahead and ignored my question and asked me, what is your affiliation with Alex Jones? And he named a couple other names real fast. I think the third name was Lewis or something like that, and I didn't recognize any of the names. So I said, well, I'm a filmmaker. I do little things with him here and there. You know, I'm a patriot. I bear, other articles, and I'm into real journalism. that was pretty much it. And, at that time, my girlfriend poked her head out the door, and I just told him, you guys got to leave, but this is the end of it, And they pretty much told her, as soon as I said, record them, they probably stole her pointer, you cannot record us.
By the way, on your own property, total First Amendment, and if it's in public, you can film, so they try to tell her, don't film us.
Oh, there's no touching of the First Amendment, Alex. But anyways, so I told her, yes, film anyway, it's a private property. And so immediately right then, she's already kind of shaken up, like, what in the world is going on here? So right then, he has kind of looked at us, we'll be watching you, Mr. Blackwood. Then they walk out with these two big snarling thugs in the fatigues. And so then they stormed their way out. And I'm just, I hadn't heard a film. I just try to run in, get the GoPro cam, and run out there and try to get a shot as they leave. But I was just make out there fast enough.
These guys are dressed up to play army, and they really want a war with us. I mean, I don't know. They show up with two guys in black fatigues. I'm just going to start laughing at them. Like, give me a break, man.
Go join the army and fight
Al-Qaeda that works for you. Literally. I mean, these people work for a government that runs Al-Qaeda. This is not...
And welcome back to the show, everybody. Let's go into some articles. Nancy Pelosi stating that the Iraq situation, which is boiling over into extreme, what would be violence and civil war, is not our problem. She says, quote, I don't think this is our responsibility, unquote. Now, I'll say this. I do not want to see another war in Iraq. I don't want to see thousands and thousands of troops, United States troops, and tons of our money being going back over there, replenishing and funding stuff that should have already been done in the past, or if you want to be technical, a war that should have never been done in the first place. So I have an issue with us going in and getting too involved with this on one sense, but on another variable, we do have to acknowledge and take the responsibility. The United States was the one that created the mess in Iraq. And if you go back in history, once upon a time, in order to fight Iran and to get at them, once upon a time, we teamed up with Saddam Hussein, gave him weapons to fight and go against Iran. And what do we do a couple decades later? Literally. We go in and take over Saddam Hussein and claim weapons of mass destruction. Kind of interesting. So we do have a responsibility, but we have to think about how we're going to deal with this before we just go jump into a situation and pour a bunch of gasoline on the fire. The Great Lakes finally ice-free after a record ice longevity, according to an article by Kristen Rodman of AccuWeather.com, which is a staff writer from them. So the actual AccuWeather.com is saying for themselves, not Kari Ilonummi, which many of you want to label as right-wing, conservative, anti-Obama. But it's the mainstream news and folks as such telling you for themselves and actual science from the weather company letting you know that the ice just finally thawed out. So when you have ice that doesn't thaw out until literally June of the following year, of the year, they call that global warming. Well, remember when they called global warming record high temperatures? Now when it gets record low, they use the same word, global warming. It doesn't make any sense. Anyway, it is what it is. So, Obama says, our future rests, unquote, on the success of Dream Kids. Dream Kids. Now, what is Dream Kids? Our future rests on the success of the children. Yes, I'm always talking about investing in future generations, investing in them and whatnot. And that ends up coming out and moving forward. So what are these so-called Dream Kids that Obama is talking about? These are the children that are being brought over illegally. Now, this is a very interesting situation. Some of these topics probably make me sound pretty hardcore, right-wing conservative, as I mentioned earlier, against what would be immigrants or against ethnic minorities. I'm not against ethnic minorities. As a matter of fact, if we were to bring 10, 15,000 skilled jobs and laborers here, engineers and quality folks in education, it would probably be a benefit to our community, honestly, and the United States. Now, I'm not saying to start outsourcing everything to other countries. I'm talking about bringing the best of the best, the stuff that we've shipped overseas over the last four decades, bring it back, and it could benefit us here if we were to start manufacturing and to start doing our own thing, acting American and whatnot, and get away from the free trade globalist doctrines, which I do highly recommend. But we're in a very interesting situation. I'll be going more into this in the future with a special on what's happening at the Border Patrol on the south part of the United States, in which they are bringing in, as I mentioned, illegals that are Mexican, Guatemalan, and from other countries. And this is the situation that we're in, and Obama is the one that's clearing the way and the path for these folks. Now, this sounds a bit out there, and I like to keep it to the science, but it would appear as if what they're trying to do is bring over these children and youth and to help change what would be the voting demographic over decades to come, to help get votes in the future that are going to be more likely to go against, say, your Second Amendment rights. And what I mean by that may sound like a conspiracy theory, but it's really not. I mean, honestly, if you bring in a bunch of people that are from Mexico or countries, even Canada, that never had guns, they're against guns, they don't have a right to have guns in general, guess what? They're going to naturally bring their ideologies here and do the same thing and be against what would be Second Amendment and guns. And that's just common sense. If you were raised around an environment that was against something or for something, you're going to take some of those ideologies and those are going to affect you and be a foundation of your personality forever. If you were raised in a family in which had a bunch of guns around the house, your parents and grandparents shot them, your little sister was even shown how to use them for fun, for self-defense and hunting and this and that, would you be scared of guns if you walked into a room and someone had a gun on their side or a 12-gauge shotgun above on their mantle, their fireplace? No, you wouldn't be intimidated at all because you're used to and accustomed to those things. Now, if you were from Mexico and the only time you ever saw or heard of a gun was when it was used in a crime, by an outlaw and some innocent person, bystanders, was being murdered or raped, if that was the only circumstances and exposure to firearms that you had, being from one of these other countries, and you come to the United States, of course you're going to vote against firearm rights. You're going to blame and equate guns to the problem, and you can't help it. But some folks in our government that know better can help it. So, and for them to try to bring in a bunch of illegals, grant them amnesty, so someday this demographic can help go against our Second Amendment rights and other variables, this is twisted. So, Obama cites Australian gun confiscation program as an example for the United States, as an example. It's not a conspiracy theory, it's an example. Now, there was a lot of crime and issues that was happening in Australia. Guns were used, but they don't tell you it was a bunch of illegal immigrants that were using them. That was a factor, that's right, legal and illegal both, that were protected and utilizing the weapons for violence and for crime. And they don't tell you, just like in our society, every time someone uses a firearm to protect themselves, such as an innocent woman in her home to protect themselves against a robber or a potential rapist. If every time you heard about one of those situations that a decent individual was able to pull their gun out of their purse, grandma was able to save herself from an attack, if you heard about those every time that you heard about Sandy Hook and other mass crazy shootings, if you heard both sides of the equation, not just every time someone falls on their guns and stumbles over it and pokes themselves on their side, Obama will, you know, fly out when that happens. But when you have a mudslide like what happened here in Oso, 44 people get killed, guess what? It takes him 30 days to get here, and he doesn't even show up on his own will. He does it because he's forced to. Now, here we go. At this point in the show, let's talk about Sheriff Mack. Now, recently, you may have heard what would be in Las Vegas, two crazy killers. They were a couple. They dressed up as the Joker. They went on a spree. They killed two police officers, an innocent bystander on the side, before killing themselves. These folks were crazy individuals. But what's interesting is, and I mentioned this in just my previous shows over the last few months, I stated, I've been talking about some of these variables for over a year, but just the last 3 months specifically, you can go back and look at variables that fit into today. I stated regarding 2 months ago, the Bundy Ranch, and what happened there, the Clyde Bundy Ranch, and how individuals were being pursued and investigated that were associated with that ranch for domestic terrorist ties. And I stated that individuals in the government and whatnot would try to use anything that they could, a crazy person or something, to bring down and make the Clyde Bundy's ranch and those folks look bad, along with any other patriotic freedom movements in America. They were going to try to make anybody that touted the Constitution, touted freedom, that loved our rights in sovereign America, as a evil, Caucasian, racist, bigot bastard that is for violence. Well, here we go, it's beginning to unfold. These crazy individuals were spotted and seen at the Clyde Bundy Ranch. That's right. So does this prove now the Bundys are crazy and they're for terrorists and cop killing? No, it doesn't prove that. What it proves is this: there's always a bad apple out there, and when you get one or two in the barrel, the whole barrel of apples in the box go bad pretty quick. If you know anything about what would be apple harvest, I lived in Eastern Washington a few years, so I got to see some of that living over in Yakima County. But this is what I will say. These crazies were actually kicked off the Bundy Ranch because their views were very out there, considered fringe and extremist by the Bundys. So when these individuals were bringing up crazy ideas of getting violent to the Bundys were not even hearing it. They actually kicked them out. And they even stated in an interview later, they believed that they were the only two that they kicked out because these two were extreme. They didn't mind people standing around with guns, willing to protect the farm and the ranch, but they did have a problem with a bunch of crazies with guns wanting to go kill cops. I have a problem with that too. So what's happening is they are associating and trying to demonize what would be the Bundys, associating them with these two crazy killers, and it goes even further. They're trying to demonize and take down other notable people, such as what would be Sheriff Mack, because there was a photograph of him taken at some rally, an event that he was at, in which the crazy guy was at too. So just because you have a patriotic person that takes a picture with somebody, later they become a killer, and now you have the Southern Poverty Law Center trying to use this to show how Sheriff Mack and others and then the Bundy Ranch and anybody that's about the Second Amendment are a bunch of kooks. This isn't right. This is inaccurate, obviously. And the lies continue to be played out. And many of you live in big cities. Many of you don't have guns. Many of you don't know what you're missing. Many of you don't know how you're being lied to. So when you see a gun, most of the time it's probably for a crime or something. And that's what's unfortunate. What we need to have is a bunch of people walking around with firearms on the outside, not concealed and hidden. We need to have them to have it in the open. And if you see people all the time with guns, you will become, step by step, less and less affected and become more desensitized. It won't be such a shock. Simple as that. So let's show the interview right now of Sheriff Mack and the circumstances regarding him and his alleged connections with the psycho killer. Catch you back after this.
CNN called me.
Okay. Asking you what?
Asking me, are you aware of this article on SPLC? And I said, no. And they said, well, didn't they talk to you? They quote you. And I said, I don't remember talking to them. I don't know when they would have called me. But anyway, I had somebody else call them, and they said, Sheriff Mack doesn't believe that you guys ever talked to him and that you're quoting him. They said, we got him on tape. And so I can tell you honestly, they had to have given a different name, because normally if the SPLC calls me, I don't hang up, but I tell them right up front, I don't like you guys, I don't trust you guys, and you're a bunch of liars. Now, what do you want to know? And the guy that claimed he called me is named Ryan Lenz. He's a reporter for SPLC. I've talked to him numerous times. If he called me and said, hey, this is Ryan Lenz with SPLC, that never happened. He either said he was somebody else or whatever, but I didn't know any of it happened until CNN called me. CNN wanted me on. They were sending somebody to pick me up. They hired a company to drive me over to a satellite receiver in Phoenix, which is about a half-hour drive. And about an hour and a half before they were supposed to come, I canceled them, because I've just never had anything like this, Ben, where somebody's trying to connect me to a guy that committed a murder. I was asked by the Libertarian Party to moderate a Meet the Candidates night with sheriff candidates in Las Vegas. I went to it. Everything was fine. It was open to the public. Wasn't my event. I was doing a book signing afterwards. Several people asked me to take pictures, and this idiot was one of them.
And so he wasn't affiliated with any of the events in any way, any official capacity. He just came up and said, will you take a picture with me? And you guys took a picture together.
That's it. That's the beginning, and that's the end of it.
And no other relationship with this guy whatsoever. How about at Bundy Ranch? Did you see him at the Bundy Ranch?
No, never heard of him, never saw him.
Did not see him there. There's a story that supposedly he was at the Bundy Ranch and he was told to leave at one point. Do you know if that's true?
One of the Bundy sons, I believe it was Ammon, said, his quote, I haven't talked to Ammon, I could anytime I want. He's really good friends with me. And he lives here in the Phoenix area. The report is that, and I've seen the report several places, that he said that the Millers were asked to leave, and they did, and they were the only people ever asked to leave. And they, you look at my police career, I was in law enforcement 20 years. Never once did I ever shoot anybody, nightstick anybody, mace anybody. I never even beat anybody up. I never slugged another human being in my life. And I've never professed violence. I've been totally against violence. I stood against violence as a cop, as a street cop, as a patrol officer, as a patrol sergeant, as a sheriff. And we even had the Earth Firsters protesting in my county. I protected them against other state police that wanted to attack them and get their attack dogs and arrest them all, beat them all up, maybe even worse. And I protected the Earth Firsters so I couldn't stand their bunch of dirty hippies. And instead, I challenged the Earth First hippies to a basketball game, and so I could make sure they finally got a shower. So at the community college, the guy in charge of the gym was my old football coach. And so I went to him and I said, lad, these guys need a bath, so let's have a public basketball game where the cops play the Earth Firsters. And we beat them really bad, but then they were given free showers afterwards. And I always had to deal with these people, so that was my subterfuge. The only thing I ever did to anybody is I made them take a shower after the basketball.
And welcome back to the show, and we continue. So you got to hear Sheriff Mack for yourself. Doesn't seem like a real crazy, violent, mean man. He even stated that he didn't even use physical force on people throughout his years in service as a police officer. And seems like a pretty decent guy to me. There you go. That's the other side of the story. And that's what I'm known for doing here at NoSpinNewsSource.com. I show you the bigger picture. I show you elements that the other folks in mainstream right and left propaganda and mainstream news seem to conveniently leave out. I go places that make you feel uncomfortable and question what you think is normal, what you think is real, what you think you know. And sometimes it makes you feel insecure inside. But that's okay, because if you're here, you either seek the truth or you're trying to figure out how to counteract the truth. One of the two, if you're watching my show. So we continue. Pope Francis says, quote, "We are discarding an entire generation to maintain an economic system that can't hold up anymore," unquote. And he's absolutely correct. If we continue to try to prop up this financial system that's based upon financial derivatives, toxic debt, phony money, stuff that's not real, speculation, if we continue to do this, the whole system does fall apart, it will, and we will see the world's reduction in human population. As folks from the Club of Rome, such as the Queen of England, explicitly has stated before, along with her husband, Prince Philip, which stated in Der Spiegel, a quote by Der Spiegel magazine, that quote, if I were to come back as a, if there is such things as reincarnation, Prince Philip states, he wishes to come back as a deadly virus to bring down the world's population, unquote. So, kind of interesting there, what an aspiration to have for your future. Hearing fails to calm anger over the deal to free Sergeant Bergdahl. This is interesting, because while we supposedly do not negotiate with terrorists, remember that? Well, we do now, since it's now Obama, and he's a terrorist, I guess, apparently. So he released five high Taliban figures from Guantanamo Bay in exchange for what is a traitor, it sounds like, and someone who went AWOL in Afghanistan. Someone who was actually against the ideology of the war. So we have probably what would be the worst president in history right now, Barack Obama. Now some people don't want to accept that. Many of you don't. Some of you it's because he's black. So there's no way the worst could be a black guy. Others, it's because he's the guy you voted for. That's interesting. So we do have a situation of racism in America where people think he's perfect just because he's black. Other people think he's horrible based upon he's black. That doesn't mean anything. If I'm a good politician or if I'm a good news anchor or not, shouldn't be based upon if I'm white or black. Shouldn't be based upon if I've got long hair. Shouldn't be based upon the fact I'm 6'4", 200 pounds. These things shouldn't have nothing to do with it. I might be rather appealing to look at for an hour and a half on a show versus some obese guy that's 50 pounds overweight and a scraggly beard that's uneducated, doesn't have much to say, looking like Rush Limbaugh or something. But, you know, it is what it is. So we're in an interesting situation here where we are freeing terrorists. And by the way, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton made a promise to the Congress and stated that no releases of Guantanamo terrorists would be done without congressional approval and consent. The president did this without congressional consent, and here we are today. And this is sending a signal to what would be Taliban and other terrorist leaders and folks that they are gaining momentum, and the United States is the one stepping back and giving in to what would be them. And here we go. So Bergdahl wished to renounce citizenship to find Taliban, according to soldiers. He went AWOL. We're going to hear more about this over months to come. I'll be investigating and looking into it and telling you about it. Obama on the Bergdahl deal says, quote, no apologies. And right now we're going to show you the video of Obama saying that there's no apology for trading terrorists for what would be the scum of an AWOL that went astray. I say we should have left him to rot and go straight to hell. That's what we should do with the soldier, if he's American or not. When he goes against the interest of America and does something like this, we don't give him a free ride to protect him. Here's a video, and we'll see you after this break.
Don't see their children again after fighting a war. I make absolutely no apologies for making sure that we get back a young man to his parents and that the American people understand that this is somebody's child.
And welcome back. Now, you remember old Susan Rice, That's right. Former Ambassador Susan Rice to the United Nations, the one that told all the lies on Benghazi and other things. Well, the hag is back again. That's right, on Fox News in an interview through what would be actually Breitbart interview video footage here of her discussing the Bergdahl deal. And is this another fib told by Susan Rice? Kind of like the YouTube video that was racist that led to a spontaneous backlash and killing of what would be at the consulate and Stephen, what would be Ambassador Stevens? Kind of interesting. And speaking of that, even Hillary Clinton is counteracting and going against that on her own and beginning to second guess and question that herself. And we will talk about that in a minute after we see this video.
The Pentagon reportedly declared back in 2010 that he walked away from his unit. The president's national security advisor, Susan Rice, who, remember, repeated bad information on five Sunday shows in 2012 about Benghazi, was back on the air this weekend and unequivocal about Bergdahl's service.
Sergeant Bergdahl wasn't simply a hostage. He was an American prisoner of war, captured on the battlefield. He served the United States with honor and distinction.
Andrea, if anybody is going to go on the Sunday shows, and if you are her staff, don't you make sure that everything is locked down tight, and at least you give some qualification to say, we're glad he's home, we know there are some questions, we're going to get back to you with all of those, but we are glad he's home. Why not just say it that way?
I am utterly stunned that a woman in such a senior position again could repeat the same mistake by going out and repeating utter fabrication. Dana, I do not believe that for one second she didn't know the controversy around Bergdahl. I'm not sure if they're just intentionally deceitful or incompetent, but it seems like every time there's an issue, we sit around this table asking intentional deceit or incompetence. And if you do, going back to that Rolling Stone article, not exactly a conservative publication, Hastings reports that there was an official cover-up that started in the White House to put pressure on the New York Times and the Associated Press to keep Bergdahl's name out of the paper. Dana, they knew. Last week, remember, a lot of pressure on this White House about the VA. President Obama thought, if I can just shift to look like I'm helping a soldier instead of hurting one, this is a win for me. It shows how out of touch and inexperienced he is at the highest level.
I know Susan Rice. You may say a lot of things about her, but one is she's not dumb. And why she would say this, the idea that somehow they had a conspiracy in the White House to get away with this, to get through the election in 2014, is mind-boggling.
Like something like the idea that she would actually repeat talking points that were changed and she willfully knew they were changed, repeated them anyway, is so mind-boggling. Oh, wait a minute. Wasn't that about 2 years ago that the same thing happened?
I don't know. I don't talk about them.
Oh, you don't? All right. Well, maybe you should think about it if you're not going to talk about it.
Well, you can expand on it, Eric. Go ahead. No. Do you think that this is just... It does surprise me that she wouldn't have just been... She could have rounded the edges a little bit.
I don't know.
And so protected.
I don't know. They're so brazen, arrogant, and they don't...
No, that's
not
brazen. You're saying. They're dumb. They're all dumb.
You can say it, but I didn't say that. I said she's brazen and she's arrogant to go out there and say that he served with honor and distinction when some of their own reports say that he may have walked away, and not only that, may have walked away, may have collaborated. We don't even know. It's just
with all this information.
You know what? This administration is absolutely feckless. That's a great word for it. With
all this information that was there, do you actually believe that they came up with a strategy that would have gotten away with it?
They came up with a strategy in Benghazi, did they not? It was the same thing. They made up a fabricated strategy, and it...
Which you never bought from the beginning on Benghazi, and this one, what do you think?
I don't buy it one bit. No, her answers are about as straight as Lombard Street. Her combination of evasiveness and incompetence makes her as credible as a Nigerian email. When she tells the truth, it's almost entirely by accident. So when you're watching her spin, it's like watching clothes in a dryer. You get nauseous. And I think this is a strategy. It's a brilliant strategy to confuse everyone by their incompetence. You can't keep up. You can focus on one clown, but you can't focus on a three-ring circus.
So you're suggesting that she was flat out lying.
She's incompetent. This is the most incompetent group of people.
She's saying lie. No one.
They're not mutually exclusive things, though.
That's true.
They can be both.
She knew, in fact, what the story was here. That
how could she not know, Bob? How could you not know?
That's my point.
Just go on Google just to check it out. And if anyone was to be careful, it should be her.
I agree with that, Bob. We've vetted this completely. She lied about what happened in Benghazi because she was told to.
If the White House had a cartoon mascot, it would be Scooby Dubious.
All right. Okay, that's a great way to end it. All right.
And welcome back to the show, everybody. Now, former Secretary of State Hillary Rodham Clinton was just in town the other day in Seattle for a book signing a few days ago this week, as she's warming up for what will most likely be her presidential bid in 2016. She's testing the waters, and her handlers are testing the waters as well, because even though right now we're coming into a point to where we are more likely to elect probably a woman than anybody else for president, the powers that be know, with all the dirt and skeletons in Clinton's closet, there's not a real guarantee she will be the winner and victor of that at this point in the road. So they're testing the bounds, they're testing the people, and they're getting the people accustomed and used to the idea of Secretary of State, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, becoming the next president in office. Now, here is Secretary of State Clinton, former secretary rather, stating a little bit different of a word very briefly and beginning to second guess what would be the YouTube video that spontaneously led to the alleged attack out of nowhere that was not orchestrated in Benghazi. So check out this interview and we'll see you right back.
It's a special report. I am joined now by my colleague and host of On the Record, Greta Van Susteren. Hello, Greta.
Hello, Brett. And we are pleased to welcome to our set former Secretary of State, former New York Senator, and former First Lady Hillary Clinton, author of the current best-selling book, Hard Choices.
Thank you very much for being here, Madam Secretary.
Thank you both.
We really appreciate it. Really quickly, a quick word on the format. Mm-hmm. We have 30 minutes with Secretary Clinton. I'll start the questioning for 7 minutes, followed by 7 minutes from Greta, and we'll take a break at the top of the hour and do it all again. So let's begin. Madam Secretary, obviously the big news today is on Benghazi, mm-hmm. and the capture of Abu Khattalib. Mm-hmm. I heard you earlier today say by way of context that it took more than 10 years mm-hmm. to pinpoint Osama bin Laden.
Right.
Isn't there a difference in this case in that Abu Khattalib was hiding in plain sight, openly giving interviews to reporters mm-hmm. like our mm-hmm. own Greg Palka?
Well, that is absolutely true, Brett, that he was in a certain part of Libya, and he was well protected. And to try to mount an operation such as was carried out successfully on Sunday posed different challenges than the ones that our intelligence forces faced in trying to actually pinpoint bin Laden and then carry out a dangerous operation. But my point is that what we try to do in this country, and I think what was made abundantly clear by this latest effort, is we have an unwavering commitment to go after anyone, no matter how long it takes, who is responsible for harming Americans. And everybody around the world who thinks about that, plans that, needs to know that will be the outcome.
Should Khattalib be read his Miranda rights and be tried in U.S. civilian court?
I don't know all the details about what the plans are, but I believe...
But if you were president...
Well, if I were president and the FBI and the Justice Department and our law enforcement came and said, we're finally ready, Mr. or Madam President, to go and capture and detain this terrorist, and we have enough evidence to successfully prosecute him in our courts, which have proven very successful at prosecuting terrorists, I would say then I'm ready to give the order.
I have some more specific Benghazi questions. You may okay. have imagined that. You write in your book that as the attack is happening, you're on the 7th floor of the mm-hmm. State Department, and then you go to your Washington home, mm-hmm. still in direct communication. Mm-hmm. Your Deputy Assistant Secretary, Charlene Lamb, testified before Congress that on the night she was in the Diplomatic Security Command Center in Washington, was in real-time contact with the Diplomatic Security Agency, agent, who was manning the Tactical Operations Center on the grounds in Benghazi. He had alerted the embassy in Tripoli, the CIA, the Bureau of Diplomatic Security in Washington. Did you talk to Charlene Lamb that evening?
No, I did not, but I was in direct communication with everyone who was. She was not the only one who was monitoring the phone lines, because contrary to some of the reports, we did not have real-time video that enabled us to follow what was going on the ground. It wasn't until sometime later that we got the security camera video from the compound that we were able to analyze. But we were in direct communication insofar as it was possible, because remember, they were under heavy attack. We had a lot going on for those diplomatic security officers to deal with. And then, as you know, the attack later moved to the CIA annex.
Did you talk to Secretary Panetta that night?
I talked with Director Petraeus. I talked on a video, secure video conference with a full array of officials. I knew because I had talked with the National Security Advisor, Tom Donilon, that both Secretary Panetta and General Dempsey were doing everything they could. We had open lines. I can't recall. I know that the Defense Department was in the room in the video conference that I held.
Madam Secretary, in your testimony before the Senate on Benghazi in January 2013, you stated this, quote, "I certainly did not know of any reports that contradicted the intelligence community talking points at the time that Ambassador Rice went on the TV shows, the Sunday shows." Mm-hmm. Do you stand by that statement?
I do, Brett, and I wrote about this at length in my book, a whole chapter on the attack on Benghazi. This was the fog of war. You know, my own assessment careened from, you know, the video had something to do with it, the video had nothing to do with it. It may have affected some people, it didn't affect other people. And I think the conclusion to draw, because we were not just monitoring what was happening in Benghazi once it began to unfold, but remember we had a very dangerous assault on our embassy in Cairo that same day, which was clearly linked to that video. So I was trying to make sense of it. And, you know, I think that the investigations that have been carried out basically conclude we can't say that everybody was influenced and we can't say everybody wasn't. But what the intelligence community said was spontaneous protests, and that is what, at the time, they thought.
Did in the Benghazi chapter, you acknowledged that on the night of the attacks, you received a State Department Operations Center bulletin, in which, in the book, you say it's a report that Ansar al-Sharia has claimed responsibility. How did that report come to you?
It came to me as those reports do to the Secretary of State. It was orally delivered. It was, you know, a monitoring of a Facebook account that said that. And then, as you know, and as I write in my chapter, that was reversed. So,
although Ansar al-Sharia didn't fully pull it back, they said they didn't participate in this popular uprising as a separate entity. So,
well, there's no doubt terrorists were involved. There is no doubt. And I, from the very beginning, and in my statements, as you know, and as I write in the chapter, said that, you know, these were attackers. Now, who was leading them? We think we now have one of the ringleaders in custody, but others were either motivated because of their extremism and their ideology, and others came along for the ride, and maybe others also were motivated by the video.
The timeline suggests, President Obama, you had a conversation on the phone, roughly around 10 p.m.
Yes.
Do you talk to him before you put out a statement or after?
Well, I didn't always talk to him before or after when I put out statements. We were in close communication.
That night.
Oh, that night, that statement went out. You know, I don't know the exact timing. My recollection is it went out before.
Before the statement. Yeah. Do you know where the president was through the attack?
The president was in the White House. The president was in the Oval Office when I got word of the attack, and I called the White House asking for National Security Advisor Donilon, who is our point of contact for the entire government, which would mean CIA, DOD, and others. And I was told, well, he's in with the president and with Secretary Panetta and General Dempsey. And I said, well, I need to talk to all of them. And I know from my conversations with Panetta, Dempsey, and Donilon, and the president, that at that moment, the president said to our defense officials, do everything you can to help our people.
Either before or after that, at 10:07, you put out this press release saying, quote, I condemn in the strongest terms the attack on our mission in Benghazi today. Some have sought to justify this vicious behavior as a response to inflammatory material posted on the internet. The United States deplores any intentional effort to denigrate the religious beliefs of others. Our commitment to religious tolerance goes back to the very beginning of our nation. But let me be clear, there is never any justification for violent acts of this kind. Did you talk about the video with President Obama?
I don't know that I talked about it with him at that conversation. We had since on numerous occasions, because part of what we were trying to sort out is what caused this. I mean, I had a very clear sense of priorities. Protect our people, get them to safety, make sure that other attacks or threatened attacks at other embassies or other American posts are not going to happen. We need to get much more support from the governments of the countries where we are posting our people. And let's learn what happened so that we can try to prevent it in real time. So I know that there is a lot of questions, and I know you and your viewers have a lot of questions. And I would recommend that people read the unclassified version of the Accountability Review Board, which you can get off the State Department website. Read what congressional committees have already put out, because you will get the best information we currently have.
I welcome back to the show. The NRA calls open carry protest, quote, weird, unquote. But of course, if you know anything about the NRA, you know they're pretty kind of wishy-washy in the middle. I'm a lifetime member of the NRA, but they're not the strongest gun rights organization out there. GOA, Gun Owners of America is the strongest that's out there. Those are the ones that I really look up to and respect. So I support them all because they're all doing something, but it is what it is. New Hampshire passes a bill outlining NSA data collection, which awaits the governor's signature there. Half the country makes less than $27,520 a year. That's right. Half the country makes less than $27,500 a year. That's not good, folks. It's very bad. Step by step, the standards of living are fading away. Most of us used to go out to eat at least twice a week. Most of us now aren't going out to eat more than once a month. Interesting. The American dream is impossible to achieve in this country, according to a lot of people. So nearly 6 in 10 people who responded to a CNN Money's American poll conducted by ORC International stated that they feel the dream, however they define it, as the American dream, is out of reach. Also, women in Washington State are now taking the lead in what would be the number of folks signing up for concealed weapons permits in Washington State. Isn't that interesting? Women are taking back their rights and their power, and they're stepping onto the scene. It's a good thing to see. I don't support Hillary Clinton because she supported the worst policies of that of Barack Obama. But I would be delighted to see a decent quality woman president, such as someday Keisha Rogers, or what would be perhaps in the very near future, someone that supports Glass-Steagall as well, National Bank and the Constitution, rule of law, Diane Sayre, former governor, candidate for governor in the New Jersey race this year. Two wonderful, very powerful women that have a chance. One woman in which I don't agree with many of her laws, but I do like the aspect of Glass-Steagall, is Elizabeth Warren, which is a senator. She's somebody that I would consider supporting. I'm not sure her and I see eye to eye on guns, but we can figure something out, right? Now, Obama says that he supports gay marriage, right? Of course he does. But has Obama always supported gay marriage? How about I show you video, YouTube footage now of Obama stating as a candidate years ago for the Senate race out of Illinois, not too many years ago, that he does not support gay marriage and that he thinks marriage is something in which scripturally is sacred and therefore is between a man and a woman. Let's watch this video and see if he really is so supportive of the gays after all.
Gay relationships, what is your position there? He's got this, he says, the Bible says, as a matter of logic, it's not right because
you know, I have been very clear on this. I have said that I am not a supporter of gay marriage. I think that the term marriage itself has strong religious roots and a strong tradition that means something special to people in this country.
And welcome back to the show, ladies and gentlemen. Now, many of you are aware of the primary race out of the East Coast of what will be regarding Eric Cantor. He lost by approximately 10 percentage points, a huge upset to the establishment, big money puller, someone who is considered as Wall Street's towelboy. Lost the primary elections to some Tea Party associated individual that likes the Constitution, according to him. And they didn't have really any money to even compete against Wall Street. But this individual beat by 10 percentage points one of the biggest folks in the Congress. Consider number two on the GOP side, Eric Cantor. Au revoir. Bye-bye. You're gone. You're out of here. Even if he wins what would be the general election, the fact that he lost the primaries by so hard shows that he's on the doorstep of being tossed out. So it may not be this year, but I bet you 2 years from now for sure. Ta-ta, Eric. Just like I'm forecasting, it's going to be an end to a lot of other congressional members as well, as they're fading away. We're going to see a lot of these big power hitters in the Senate, like Senator Harry Reid and other folks. They're going to start losing their re-elections. You wait and see. I hope to God Harry Reid loses a 2016 presidential race. If he runs at all in Nevada for Senate. I hope he doesn't run at all. That's just me. So, Dick Cheney, you remember him? He wasn't exactly known for causing peace in the world. Well, Dick Cheney is standing up against Obama, if you want to call it that, and he is saying that he doesn't agree with Obama's policies. He's not getting very specific, and I have a feeling they're just playing politics to make the GOP side look good, himself, along with past history, look good, and perhaps the woman standing next to him, which wants to be a congressional member someday, Lynn Cheney, that ultimately, here we are. So check out this video of Dick Cheney sounding as if he's trying to be American. Catch you back.
I'm Liz Cheney.
I'm Dick Cheney. We stand at a critical moment in the life of our nation. The policies of the last 6 years have left America diminished and weakened. Our enemies no longer fear us. Our allies no longer trust us. Empty threats, meaningless red lines, leading from behind, and engagement with rogue regimes have put America on a path of decline. Threats to America's security are on the rise. Iran is marching toward a nuclear weapon. Al-Qaeda is resurgent, establishing new safe havens across the Middle East, including in Iraq, where President Obama withdrew all American forces with no stay-behind agreement. He has announced he intends to do the same in Afghanistan. Syria has become the most dangerous training ground for Islamic terrorists since the attacks of 9/11. President Obama has repeatedly misled the American people about the attacks in Benghazi and the true nature of the threat we face.
We're forming the Alliance for a Strong America because we know America's security depends upon our ability to reverse President Obama's policies. We know that America is the exceptional nation and that there is no substitute for American leadership around the world. We know that America's armed forces are the greatest fighting force and the greatest force for good the world has ever known. The Alliance for a Strong America will educate about and advocate for the policies needed to restore American power and preeminence. We will provide information to citizens about national security and defense policy and ensure that these issues are a critical part of America's national debate and discussion over the next 2 years and beyond.
In March 1983, President Ronald Reagan said, "It is up to us in our time to choose and choose wisely between the hard but necessary task of preserving peace and freedom and the temptation to ignore our duty and blindly hope for the best while the enemies of freedom grow stronger day by day. We hope you will join us in the hard but necessary task of restoring American strength and power."
Join us today.
And welcome back to the show, everybody. Suspended animation trials to begin on humans very shortly. The VA scandal being used to push privatization of what would be the VA healthcare services. That's right. According to what would be Prince Charles, the Queen's son, that he has stated about Vladimir Putin, "Putin is behaving just like Hitler," unquote. That's exact quote. "Putin is behaving just like Hitler," according to what would be the prince. So, regarding the verdict on the Russian leader's invasion of Ukraine, that's what he stated. Well, it's kind of funny, of all people, talk about people acting like Hitler, and it's the Queen of England and her family. Genetically modified super banana coming to America soon to be tested on us. After attack near campus, California weighs a gun bill. Hillary Clinton states that she is the real victim of Benghazi, which is not even a funny joke, if I should say so. It's a pretty sick joke at that, and whatnot. Very interesting. Now we have an article, actually what would be a CBS News interview right now with Charlie Rose, with former CIA Director Mike Morell, regarding what would be a warning that there could be an ISIS terrorist attack in the United States of America. And we'll check you out in just a minute.
But Deputy CIA Director serving in that role during the second Iraq War. Mike, good morning.
Good morning, Charlie.
Let me begin with this question of Iran. There, Clarissa confirmed, that CBS News confirmed, that General Soleimani, head of the Quds forces in Baghdad, How can we operate and work with the Iranians in combating this march towards Baghdad?
Charlie, I do not believe that it is in the interest of the United States for us to work with Iran. There is a long-term struggle going on in the Middle East between Iran and our allies, Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, and the moderate Gulf states, a fight going on for influence. And I don't think we want to give Iran a foothold in Iraq. So we need to help the Iraqis. The moderate Gulf states need to help the Iraqis. We need to keep the Iranians out of this.
Is this a failure of American policy to focus on Iraq during the years since we left? Because Brian Crocker, the former ambassador, said yesterday, I would request that Secretary Kerry get on a plane immediately. We have lacked the high-level engagement with the Iraqis that was so crucial during my term in office. Do you agree with that?
There's a long list of mistakes that were made, Charlie. They really start with back in 2003 when the United States disbanded the Iraqi army, disbanded the Iraqi intelligence service, de-bathification. We removed the capability of the Iraqi state to deal with problems like this. Maliki himself has created problems. He has created resentment among the Sunnis. That's why they're supporting ISIS. So Maliki's been a problem. Maliki wouldn't work with us for a couple of years after the withdrawal of U.S. forces. That was a problem. So there are many, many, many problems here, Charlie, and we're now paying the price for them.
Mike, let's just take a step back. I mean, what is the goal of ISIS? This is a militant group. It's a Al-Qaeda offshoot. What do they want? They want to attack the United States in the future, or is this about an Islamist caliphate?
So there's two goals, I think, Nora. One is to set up that caliphate, and it's not just in Iraq and in Syria. If you actually translate the name of the group, it is it translates as the Islamic State of Iraq and Greater Syria, which means all of the Levant. So it's that whole area that they want to control. So that's their first goal. Their second goal then is to use that as a safe haven to attack the United States.
And is that the biggest concern for U.S. intelligence?
I think there are a number of concerns here. One is a very bloody sectarian war that kills civilians, humanitarian crisis. I think it's a potential gift to Iran. I think there's a broader risk to stability in the region. I think the risk to the United States homeland is real. And I think the risk of Iraq breaking up and the Kurds wanting to form their own state and what that means for Kurds in Turkey and Kurds in Iran and Iran wanting to join them is also something we need to worry about. This is a very, very big deal.
It is deeply disturbing.
And welcome back, everybody, to the show, for the Monthly Report Show. Glass-Steagall moves forward in Italy while the Eurozone pushes bail-in mechanism. That's right, and I've been discussing the bail-in, just like bailouts, for some time now. Well, here we are and here we go. Remember, they're going to take your money, 401ks, pensions, retirements, the veterans, money that would go for what would be their health care and retirements and this and that. Bye-bye. It's all going bye-bye. Now, what's interesting is this. I think it's sad. I think it's unfortunate. I see farmers going out of business. I see people losing their homes. I see a lot of things happening, but it's not enough for most of you to get up and moving yet. So apparently, life hasn't got hard enough for many of you. That's unfortunate, but it's just how it is. Just like this year, Rick Larson's going to win again, if I was running against him or otherwise. Because right now, the truth doesn't really matter. It should. On a moral sense, it matters. Someone up there believes it matters. I believe that. And some that are decent otherwise, folks, they care. But most of the folks that are out there in this nation, our wonderful United States, have become so demoralized, so pessimistic, so beaten up in society. They're just out doing their own little thing to please themselves. And as long as they have their little piece of the pie, they're okay. So unfortunately, the neighbor's home being foreclosed upon or farm being taken or this or that isn't enough for many of you to get up and do the right thing. So apparently you and your families will have to hurt too. You'll have to be worried about skid row, starvation, losing your home, losing health care, education, and your futures, and then many of you will want to become more active in shaping your political circumstances, and maybe then you will help to provide good representation and leaders in your community city council members, mayors, state reps, county reps, congress members. So it is what it is. Pope Francis states, we are, quote, we are discarding an entire generation to maintain an economic system that can't uphold anymore. As long as you capitulate to government, even if it's because you're scared and you're too stupid to otherwise know what to do. When you have good people that otherwise crawl into a hole and let evil win and take over, your lives, my life, everybody's life around is going to get a lot worse before it begins to really get better. So there's a lot of optimism. There's decent people like me coming onto the scene with websites and shows being seen around the world. But guess what? We still haven't changed things yet. We still haven't got average base America yet up and moving. Folks like me are organizing and trying with the fervor. But individually, you have to make the decision to decide that you want better leaders in government and you're not going to accept the games and lies any longer. Bashar al-Assad posts, president of Syria, an open letter of thanks for his fight against terrorism from Virginia State Senator Black. That's right, Virginia State Senator Black gave a letter to Syria, the president there, in expressing what would be his thankfulness for the fact that Assad is fighting the terrorist rebels. He's doing more against them than we are. The United States is funding those rebels. It's not going to make us look very good very shortly. Defense chief defends Taliban prisoner swap. That's right. Secretary of Defense Chuck Cagle told a contentious congressional hearing a couple weeks ago that the five Taliban leaders for the war prisoner Bo Bergdahl was an imperfect decision, but he thinks it was the right decision. Taliban commander now says that Americans now high valuable targets for kidnappings after the Bergdahl deal. See the signal we send? You kidnap even a terrorist of ours, we'll give you five of your top highest paid men. How much money did we spend, millions of dollars, to track down the alleged top five Taliban terrorists that we had at Guantanamo Bay? How much did we pay for feeding, giving them medication, torture, and other treatments for the years in which we had them there too? Millions and millions of dollars, and then we just, like the bird cage, just open it up and let them fly away. I bet that's very empowering to them. Paul Craig Roberts in Washington is planning a first nuclear strike on Russia, China. That's right. On June 3rd, posting on his website titled, quote, "Are You Ready for Nuclear War?" unquote. Former Undersecretary of Treasury under Ronald Reagan, Paul Craig Roberts, LaRouche-Back article, urges readers to, quote, pay close attention to Stephen Starr's guest column, which posted June 2nd. And he goes on to state about nuclear war has no winner. So we have what would be Treasury secretaries and major folks in and around government institutions now step by step reiterating and sounding like I am. Folks in the Senate are saying it's time for Glass-Steagall. The Pope is even saying we cannot continue to prop up speculation. It's the end of the line and we're funding and financing and holding up a structure that has faded away and doesn't need to be propped up any longer. We have individuals as such stating that we're on the brink of World War III against Russia and China explicitly. This is what I've been saying too. I've been saying that for a couple of years, and lately it's just starting to show. I haven't talked a whole lot about the World War III scenario because we were caught up in other variables and I realized it was a little too far for many of you. Even though some of you may think my show is rather potent and extreme and fringe as it is, believe it or not, I try to put you in the kiddie pool before I toss you in the whirlpool. I try to take you step by step. I already know a couple of things I'll be discussing over the next month or two that I won't even bring up here today because the people aren't ready for it. And I'm going to develop more of an understanding, and then I'm going to approach it over the next couple of months when we are ready to talk about it. So, I'm Kari Ilonummi. This is a NoSpinNewsSource.com July edition, 3-year mark for NoSpinNewsSource.com. I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you for coming to the website. God bless you. There's farms in the area. I won't say your names because I don't want negative attention onto you. But I appreciate what you're doing. You're going out on a whim for me. I will remember that, and I'm here for you. God bless you. Thank you all. I will see you next month with an amazing edition of what would be the August monthly report. see you soon. I'm getting ready to go see Yngwie Malmsteen, Kiss, and a couple other bands over the next week. So thank you, and we'll see you soon. Enjoy nature, take care of yourself and each other, and instead of being there to bash your neighbor when he falls, instead of take advantage of him like wolves in nature, be there and give him a helping hand. Because remember, what goes around comes around, and someday many of you that don't yet care now will lose their homes, their jobs, will see their kids on Skid Row or grandkids, and many of you are going to be on the ground with reaching up for a helping hand of compassion. And I guarantee you're going to want that hand to reach back and lift you off the ground. God forbid you're placed there. The price of food's going up. You're going to see foreclosures going up. Jobs are going to become harder to attain. And your life and living standards is going to become more and more difficult to the point to where you decide to change things. I hate to see things going down in America, but I look forward to the day that you are insecure enough with your own living situation and shooken and scared just enough to be shocked out of the rut, to get away from Seahawks bullshit football and games and get to reality and start doing what I'm doing, Alex Jones is doing, Lyndon LaRouche, and other patriots across the nation. So defend and stand up for folks such as Lyndon LaRouche, Alex Jones, or myself. Buy their products, support them, tell your friends and community. Many of you don't understand what's going on yet. Many of you don't have the guts to quite come out and really argue against this stuff yet. But all you gotta do is hand them my card and website. Let me handle them. Just say, hey, check this out. Tell me what you think. Quick conversation, done and over. See you soon, God bless. Catch you back in a month, and we'll be back here on the bridge for another edition of the Monthly Report. See you soon. Ta-ta.